Welcome to BA 499, and for those of you watching online, welcome, and we're going to get started here. First, we're going to go over the syllabus, and we've got lots of other things. One word of caution, I do want to give the online students before I get going. The camera makes me look older than I am, heavier than I am, and my hair is grayer, and I'm taller than I'm not as short as it looks. So other than that, everything should be fine. So, all right, syllabus. I think you all probably have looked at it or should have looked at it. It's online. I gave you a copy of it. The syllabus is located right at the top of the Moodle site. This site is for the online, for the face-to-face class, but it looks identical for the online class. So take the time to read that. My office hours are there. I also want to go ahead and give you my cell phone number. You can place it here on your syllabus. My cell phone number is 1-800-273-9000 as well, and it's only going to be used for a short amount of time, and that number is 1-800-273-9000 number. I'm going to be in Mexico for 10 days in the middle of this class. As long as I'm in my hotel room, I will hear that phone ring because it's hooked to my computer there. I have to be on Wi-Fi. So email is probably the best when I'm traveling, but if you do want to talk to me, or I'll say I'm in my room, go ahead and call me. It's easier to talk on the phone. Okay, so you'll have that number. That number will only be good the 15th through the 26th of January. That you can see on your schedule where we'll be gone. Okay, everybody should be familiar with Moodle sites. I've spent the last 30 hours getting this Moodle site exactly how I want it for the first 2 weeks. Not sure where those other 30 hours are going to come from for the next 2 weeks. Looking at the schedule here on the syllabus on the second page, the layout of the course is pretty much consistent after we get going. I'm going to talk a lot about what the expectations are of the class today. We'll go over, I'm going to give you a lot of handouts. For those of you online, I will say where those handouts are located. We're going to talk about the interview that you need to conduct sooner than later. We're also going to talk about a business plan that you're going to evaluate. I'm going to give you that business plan. For those of you online, I put a bunch of business plans online for you. And you'll do them together as a peer group. And for those of you in here, you'll decide on your own peer groups. For those of you online, I need to assign your peer groups to you. And you'll be required to do a four-slide video, four-slide PowerPoint. Okay, on Monday next week, you're going to meet with the librarian in room 113. It says it here on your syllabus. Okay, but until then, we need to work on our interview, getting the group PowerPoints done, and making sure that we move forward. All right, let's look at the syllabus. First of all, as you see, we'll talk about the chapters, and then that week, at the end of the week, you'll have that time to talk about it. So what we're going to do each Monday and Wednesday after we get on a roll is Monday I will talk about it, you'll write about it, Wednesday I'll review it just before. So we may be talking about one section prior, 2 weeks before we talk about it, but we'll always review it. So where it says reviews on here, starting I think the 5th of February, every Wednesday is a review. It's to get you ready for the work that you have to write that weekend. Okay, so even though we may get ahead, students have told me, yeah, you talked about that 2 weeks ago, and now I'm writing it on this weekend. So those reviews are for us to go back and talk about just what you're going to write that weekend. Okay, but talk about it far enough ahead of time that you can get started on it. You'll be doing peer reviews for each person. I will tell you that the peer review feedback that you give your colleagues and that you post your drafts each week, I take very seriously. I write all over every single one of them. It usually takes me about 20 hours per class to do that. So I take it pretty seriously that you, if you do the same thing wrong again the next time, my motto is, I will work as hard as you work in this class. Don't ask me to work harder. So if I'm spending more time grading it than you are writing it, we've got a problem. Okay? So you will do those peer reviews, those drafts and those peer reviews add up. Even though they're two percenters, they add up. They've caused people not to pass the class because they blew off all that part, even though they had a nice plan at the end. It's great feedback. I'm giving you an opportunity to show me your work, give you all kinds of good feedback. Your peers will give you good feedback, and it should be ready to go. I won't look at it again after that, but I'll only look at it if they're late. I won't look at them, and you don't get credit for it. Okay, so we all need to stay on schedule. Two things I do differently in this 499 than you may have heard in other classes. I put the company description at the end. It's hard to write. You all have an idea, or should by now, or will by the end of the day. It's hard enough to come up with your idea, but it's really hard to then write a description about it before you've done any research. So I move the company description to the end, where it's real easy to write, because now you know everything. The other thing I do is I present the financials today, okay? And when you present your 499, you present the financials first. Because I'm on to you guys. You think if you do a bunch of ums and drag them on, you'll never get to those financials at the end. Okay? So we talked about the financials first in the presentation. So bring your financials sheet that I'm going to give you here in a minute with you every day to class, because something might come up, but it's not going to be something we're going to write this whole paper and then all of a sudden 1 week we're going to talk about financials. Okay? It's going to be incorporated into the whole time. Okay? How many of you still do not have a plan put on Moodle? Okay, how many of you are having trouble deciding on a plan? You kind of know what you want? Okay, so we're not at scratch there. Okay, how many of you have I read and approved it? I stopped about 8 o'clock last night. Okay, so I've got a bunch of work to do today. The rest of you have submitted something on there. The things that I wrote back on them, and I think I then sent an email out to everybody, you really need to make sure you have in-text citations and the reference there. Okay, I want you to get in the habit of that right away because that's an expectation of the paper. Okay, the other thing is I want you to make sure that you're using data that you've researched that's evidence to show that this is a good idea. Okay, and that's what your whole industry analysis is going to be. You're going to be looking to see what's the growth in this industry. How healthy is it? Where is it moving to? Am I moving in the right direction? Am I going to go start building, buggies again and we're moving off into space cars? So am I moving in the right direction and finding the trends of what's going on in the industry? And that's going to be really important. And the good thing for you guys that I'll be gone that week to Mexico is that you will have that extra time to just do some research. And Connie, our librarian, which we'll speak to on Monday, is very, how many of you worked with Connie? Yeah, she is great. She is School of Business librarian. She wants you to come to her. Have you ever worked at a job and there's no business, how boring it is? Okay, and you're sitting there. Connie wants you to come. She gives you ways to chat with her. She gives you ways to email her, to call her, to come into the library. Take advantage of that. She will help you. You get stuck. I'm going to say, if you say, I can't find any industry information on this, all I'm going to say is go to Connie, okay? So use Connie as much as you can. It's going to pay off for you because that is one of the most important sections of the 499 capstone classes, the industry analysis, okay? There's others that are important too, but you really got to have a good, solid knowledge of the industry that you're going into before you can start writing a paper. All right, on Moodle, you guys have probably had some time to look at it. The syllabus, which I just handed you, is there. Some of you may have a fourth or fifth edition, and I made the changes to the fifth. Anybody in that? You all have fifth editions? Okay, if you have fifth editions, then what you can do is check this out. What I've done is also printed that for you. I was trying to eliminate a lot of printing for you. So I'll have those available if you've got the fourth. So the page numbers are just off a little bit. There's no other issue with that. This is the financial statements. First thing I want you to do when you leave class today, I want you to open that up And I want you to save it. And I want you to save it today's date. And every time you open it, I want you to save it that date. Okay? Because if you figure out that, gosh, everything I put in on Wednesday just isn't, I messed it all up. It was better how it was on Tuesday. Then you got Tuesdays to go back and start over. Okay? This spreadsheet is locked. Well, I should say it's protected. You can unprotect it. Do not. It has more formulas and functions in it that are this long. You do not want to unlock that and start messing with that. Now, once in a while, you're going to get some numbers or something that's too wide that you need the columns to be wider. You can unprotect it for a second, or if you're too scared, I'll unprotect it for a second. You make the column wide and go protect it again right away. Because I'll guarantee you, if you unprotect that, so, well, I thought I'd change that formula. I'll say, you're on your own, bud, because I have no idea what happened to that. Okay, so it is protected. Do yourself a favor. Every time you open it, save it as that date. This one down here is one that I'm giving you guys today in class, and it's printed for the online students, so when we talk about it, they can pull it up as well. And I'm going to now hand that out to all of you. How's that? Financial sheet, which is a big 11 by 17 sheet, a sheet on quotations, a sheet on paraphrasing, and I believe a second sheet on plagiarism. Students, these are located right here, and I will be adding more handouts there as I hand them out in class. So for right now, these three sheets I've just handed out in class, plus the financial sheet. What I want you to do with the financial sheet when you open it up today online and save it and put it in your nice secure place, and email it to 13 people you know and put it in your cell phone. Now, I did that with my dissertation. At the end of the night, I sent it to everybody I knew. I didn't have many friends when I got finished, but they all held on to it. So make sure you're keeping it in a safe place because there's a lot of work that goes into that. The same with the plan. The other thing I recommend that you do today is that you open a Word document and create the outline that is in the back of your book. And the outline is listed on page, which may depend on which book you're in, but page 392. And I would type that outline out in Word. So as you come up with things that you need or find, you have a placeholder for them. So whatever sections do that week, you can just grab that section out, put it in another Word document to submit it to Moodle. But then you have a running paper, and it's really quite motivating to see that paper grow from that standpoint instead of having all these separate pieces. So I recommend that you type that outline out, and as you get things, then just put them in as placeholders. So having the financial sheet open all the time and having that outline open every time you sit down is two things I really encourage. And, you know, I know that you don't always do everything I say. I don't know why, but you don't. But I have had students say, you know what, those were great tips, and I used them, and it made the process a lot easier, kept them organized. So make sure that you think about doing that. You need to do an interview of someone that is in an industry such as the one you're going into or an industry that's close. It does not have to be in the area. It can even be done by email, phone call, or in person. If this is a business that you're considering doing in a particular area, it might be best to call someone in a different area to ask them questions. So you don't want to be asking them questions and then you're going to be their competitor later on. So, but you need to find someone to interview. And there's here at the down lower here, I've got top 20 questions that might be helpful in your interview assignment. Here's your interview assignment of what to do, and then here's some questions. Now, word of caution, things that you don't want to ask them, and I think you're probably pretty obvious, you don't want to ask them how much money they make. You can ask them things, what they found most challenging, what would they do different if they opened again, do they have a business plan? That ought to really get you upset, because they'll all say no. Wow, am I right? Okay, but there's other questions that you can ask, you know, that may help you. Okay, when we think about research, we need to remember it's not just research that we do on the computer. Research from people is very valuable too, and that's where you're going to get it in this interview. So you'll be able to quote stuff in your paper from the interview as well. Okay, the other thing, trade associations are another thing you need to consider. See if your industry, your business is in a particular trade association, because that's a great place to get resources as well. Okay, so those are the main three ones, but don't forget people. Talking to people is a good thing that are in the industry. You know, they'll give you tips that you didn't think about, or things they say, gosh, I wish I'd have done this, or it'd be easier if I did this, but we can't, we're locked into this now, or, you know, I went into a great location, found out I didn't need to be prime location. I could have been off the beaten path a little bit and saved a lot of money. There's all kinds of different things that you can get back from talking to people in the industry. And I will tell you, if you approach them in a way as, I want to know about your business, I'm curious, I'm working on my capstone project and I'd like to interview you, when is a good time that I can do this? I was a business owner for many years before I came to SOU, and I tell you, business owners like to talk about their business. They're very proud of it, and there's something they want to talk about. So don't just kind of ad lib. Have some points that you're going to talk about to keep the conversation going, in case you get one of those that says, yep, nope, okay, then you can keep it going. But don't stop them from going off on a tangent. You find out some of the most valuable things. This assignment that will be due the second week, and there's a place to post it here down on the second week, right here. I don't care about its format. If it's bulleted items where you asked a question, it's bullet item, or random things that I picked up on, whatever. This is really to benefit you, and I'm just going to check that you've got it done. Okay? So it is due, your interview is due on January the 26th. That is written here in the syllabus. If you have any questions about that, I think usually what students say the most is they have trouble finding someone in that exact business. So it may be that you have to find something similar or even a complementary business to that. Because really what it is just talking to business owners. Their struggles, their challenges, and all that are kind of the same across the board. You know, I think probably what you'll hear the most if someone came to interview me is employees. Are the most difficult in business. I'd probably still be in business if I could do it all without employees. Because they come in, they've had a fight with somebody, and all of a sudden you're trying to deal with them. You don't even know what you're dealing with. Or some are motivated with money, some are motivated with a day off, some are motivated with a pat on the back. So you're constantly dealing with the psyche of all these different people. And all of a sudden you feel like, gosh, I'm all involved in your life, and all I want you to do is just put this together. So you'll find that employees are one of the biggest challenges in business, and I'd be surprised if the majority of you don't hear that when you're out interviewing. So the interview assignment is here, where you'll post it here. Here's some questions. You, by no means would you probably ask them 20 questions. No means if you have other questions that you think are unique to your business, you're okay. But be sensitive of the types of questions you do ask. You know, you don't want to ask them personal type of questions, okay? You could ask them, you know, can you give me an idea of what the capital output was to start this business? You know, and they may give you that. Or, you know, you could say, did you take out small business loans? doing, some of those things, but asking them specifics, just like you don't go ask somebody how much money they make, okay? So be mindful of some of the things that might be more sensitive, okay? Any questions on the interview? The second thing that we'll be doing, and it'll actually be due on January 15th, is today you're all going to pick from a list of business plans that I've brought in. I randomly grabbed a group of business plans. I don't know if they're good, don't know if they're bad, there's no grades on them, there's no nothing. You're going to take these business plans and read them as a group, and I hope that the groups you get into, 3 to 4 people, will also be the same group you keep throughout for your peer group. That's how I'm going to let you decide your groups, and we'll stick with them. In these business plans, you're going to do a 4-slide PowerPoint to present to the class. First slide is just tell us what the business is about in intro. Okay? Now, they're in real trouble with that plan if you can't figure it out, and sometimes we haven't been able to figure it out. Okay? Second is, what worked well? What were the strengths of the plan? Anything from how it was written, how it was put together, the detail in which they went into, all those sorts of things. And I think I put a new slide up here. business plan evaluation assignment. Okay, so I've got it there. At the end of the assignment, the instructions, there's a evaluation sheet as well. And you'll need to fill that out. Just one PowerPoint per group, one evaluation sheet per group. So make sure everyone in the group's name is reflected on both. In the PowerPoint, you'll put the intro, the strengths, what worked well, what seemed to be strong of the plan. The next one is what didn't seem to work so well. What were the weaknesses of the plan? And it could be the writing, the layout, the organization, any of those types of things that made it difficult to even get past to find out if this was a good business idea or not. Okay, and then the fourth one is, would you invest in this business or not, and why or why not? Okay, now I'm gonna go ahead and tell you now the glory I get in having you do this is because you all get up here and you go, and they did this, and can you believe they did this, and then they did this, and we couldn't even figure out this plan. And then you should have seen their financials. Huh? You just relinquished any of those problems to complain about for your own. Okay? Because I'm going, ooh, glad you're not going to do that. Okay? So look at them. They are going to be all over the board. You may grab an excellent one that still will have some weaknesses in it. They're not all perfect. Business plans are a work in progress. There's never a time that they're finished and you stick them on the shelf. If so, then you've done a business a disservice. They're to be brought down and reevaluated, look at it, make sure you're staying on the track, reestablishing goals, moving things forward, making new projections. As the business grows, the plan should grow with it. So it should be your guide for the business. So, like I said, this 10 weeks, they had to stop writing. Had to show me enough to say, yes, I understand all there is to know that you taught us in the School of Business. I understand marketing plans, I understand strategies, I understand the financials, I understand accounting, I understand all the different aspects from all the classes are going to come together and prove to me in a business plan that you're ready to graduate from SOU. And here's my one little thing I'd like to say at this point. I'm alum, I'm a double alum of SOU. I want to make sure that you're a nice good alum as well, so we can all say we're in the same pool. Okay? So, I don't give grades. You earn them. I will work as hard as you work, but I won't work harder. So if you're working your tail off and you need to call me 10 times a day, well, that's just how it's going to be. Okay? I want you all to be successful. Mediocre is not going to make it in here. If you have trouble writing, then you need to make sure you go to the writing center. Or if there's someone you know that's a good editor, great. I had a student last term that put together this paper, and I was like, oh my gosh, I can't even get past some of the writing problems. And I looked, and she's a pretty good student. I couldn't figure it out. And I told her, I said, this is not going to fly. And my famous saying is, you got to figure out how to pull a rabbit out of a hat pretty quick because this isn't going to work. And she went and got a, the next week was this beautiful paper. I said, come on, you got to tell me what happened here. She says, I went and got a program, and I'll share it with you guys, that read her paper back to her after she wrote it. And she said, well, that didn't make any sense, and she rewrote it. I'm telling you, I've never seen anything like it. It was night and day. It was a free app that she downloaded. She sent it to me, so I'll make it available to you guys. But it was amazing. I wouldn't have believed it, you know, had I not known who she was and knew that and she gave me the app right away. So whatever it takes, these papers, this is a writing class. This is a business class. It's a writing business plan class. It's a writing class, it's a grammar class, it's all those things that you might try to say it in. Because this is how you're going to prove that you're going to get your graduate degree in business. Okay. So the first paper, I'll go through it and I'll tell you all kinds of stuff, and I'm happy to do it. It will be solid green when you get it back. What I'm not happy to do is make those same corrections on the next paper. So please take those and incorporate them into the next time you turn in a paper. And then we'll all be happy. Right? So I've also put here the business plan evaluations. I'll let you get in groups. We'll do that after we turn the camera off. But I do want to take a minute to look at the financial sheet. And it's going to be brief, but I want you to start getting familiar so that when you go and look at it today, when you save it, it makes some sense. The only thing I want you to do on it, other than save it, is browse through it and click on cells and look at the formulas up top and find out what's connected. Because a lot of times a student will put a number in and go, well, how'd that number end up on that other sheet? All the sheets are linked together. And so knowing that will make a difference in how you input stuff. So let me take just a few minutes to go over some of the categories here. You can't tell from looking at this, but the areas that are in yellow backgrounds are ones that you add things to, okay? And the others are ones that will just happen because of the stuff you enter in. It says the first thing to enter, you're gonna put your company name there, okay? That'll reflect through all the sheets. The next thing you're going to enter is the starting point of your business. When is your business going to start? Listen, it's a trick question, right? When do you want to start your business?
Soon.
Soon. No, but I mean, what would be a month and a year that you would start the business? How do we determine that? I guess we don't know. You usually start, say we're going to do I have anybody doing events? I had somebody doing events in one of my classes. You're going to deal with weddings and stuff? So weddings usually happen in the spring and summer. So would you open your business at the end of summer? No, you're probably going to open 2 months before the season starts. Okay, so depending on your business, you want to get in just before the peak of the season. You never want to open a business at the end of the season. Right? You've got all that time to lose money. So you want to open up in enough time to get yourself established, but not too early and definitely not too late. So it's a little tricky. So the industry analysis may help you with that. When does this business peak? Okay, I need 3 months to get my word out, get my advertising out, get my business set up, and get going. So that's going to determine what the dates are that you say your business begins. Okay, on the sales sheet here, again, all these grayed out areas that look like it's a bad copy. It's not. I gray them out like that. Those are the places you're going to input things. Right? So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to input the different units that you're selling, whether they're service items or product items. Now, notice there's probably only about 7 or 8 slots there, and some of you may have hundreds of products or hundreds of services. For the purpose of this spreadsheet, you're going to have to categorize them because you only have 7 slots. So for instance, if someone's doing do I have a running store? Okay, I'm sorry, I'm forgetting which classes everybody's in. So you may sell apparel, shoes, accessories. You may have to lump those things together. And in all reality, not all apparel is going to cost the same. Not all shoes are going to cost the same. So we're going to have to do some averaging. But if you've got some low-end shoes, medium shoes, and high-end shoes, you could do it that way as well. But just realize you're going to have to categorize your products or services to meet the number of categories we have there. Now, some of you may just have one product and one's fine. Okay, don't try to fill the 7-Up if you don't need it. And then you add what you're going to sell the product for, what it costs you to make that product, and it figures everything else out. On the people sheet, there's two different things going on the people sheet, and we'll talk about this. This is nothing you need to remember today. This is something I'm going to just keep getting you more and more familiar with it each time. The people sheet, two things are going on here. There's the salaries at the top that say it's cost of sales, and there's salaries down in the middle that says operating expense. When would I put salaries as cost of sales, and when would I put salaries in operating expense? What's the difference? Okay, I want to know the accountants I have in this room. So why would I put some salaries in operating expense, and why would I put some salaries in cost of sales? Yes, Addie?
If your employees have to do with manufacturing versus selling the product, that be kind of a generalized?
That's kind of general.
That's direct labor. If their labor is directly affecting.
Right. And you're right, too, that so if you were only going to pay someone, every time you sold one of these, you got a dollar, or every time you made one of these, you got a dollar, then that's directly linked to the sales, and that would go in cost of sales. If you're paying someone part-time, hourly, or salary, regardless of what they sell, what they make, that is an operating expense. Now, will some people be in both?
Yes.
Yeah, sometimes you have, here's your base salary, and then you get commission on top of that. Okay. I'm not so much concerned that you get it in the right place as I am that you don't double up. Okay? Don't put it in both. It's great if you put it in the right place, but sometimes I have students, they'll put it up in the cost of sales and then put it in salary. Now you've just doubled your expenses for that employee. Okay? So be careful. So that's the main thing on this. How many of you are operating outside of Oregon? Okay? A couple of you. You'll need to go to the top of the sheet where it says taxes and benefits and make sure. If you're in Oregon, these are fine. If you're outside of Oregon, you need to look to see if maybe those need to be changed depending on the state. Now, what states are you guys going to?
California?
Alaska?
Colorado?
They all have sales tax, right? Where is sales tax going to show up on all of this? What's that?
Cost of goods sold?
No.
There's another taxes section.
No. It's not going to show up anywhere. Why?
Maybe it's not something that's directly linked to you.
Take that a little further, Amber. It's not directly linked to me, meaning what?
Meaning it's not something that's actually involved in your processes. It's just whatever your funds are, like whatever income you're making. It's something that's just added on at the end, and then it really doesn't technically touch your hands. You just pass it straight along.
Yeah. I'm just a pass-through to collect it for the state. Okay? So it doesn't really. Now, do I need to account for it and on my, at some point and add up all my invoices and do it? Yeah. But for purposes of this financial statement, they're not going to show up. So you don't need to deal with the sales taxes for the financial statements. But you will acknowledge in your plan that there is a sales tax of X number or X percentage. Okay, but we're just a holder of the state of that money, and you do not want to act as if that money is revenue. You'll get yourself in a lot of trouble because you'll see that as revenue, and it's not, and then they ask for their money, and you spent their money, and that's illegal. Okay, so for purposes, we'll just treat that this tax won't show up on here because it's a pass-through. On the next sheet, which is the income statement sheet, notice that the sales is already filled in. Where did that come from? The sales sheet that we just talked about, right? So it automatically pulls that over. It automatically pulls over our cost of sales. That might have been, that one looks, is it on the material line? If we had any salaries that were considered cost of sales, it would have automatically pulled those over. And the first thing it pulls over on the operating is it'll automatically pull in salaries and automatically pull in depreciation from the balance sheet. These other areas are all the things that you're going to include as expenses, such as, give me some examples of expenses.
Rent. Utilities.
Maybe you have a vehicle.
Insurance,
vehicle maintenance. What else? Advertising. Big one. What's that?
Salary.
Nope, salary's already pulled it over automatically from the from the people sheet.
Supplies.
Okay. What else?
Miscellaneous,
okay. Miscellaneous office supplies or something, okay. Anything else? You'll come up with things. That's where those things go. Now, this particular set of financials does not allow for a place for startup expenses, so they will all be included in that first column for the first column. Okay? With the exception of what?
Loans.
For vehicles or big equipment, anything that we consider assets of more than, we usually say $3,000 to $5,000. So it's back and forth of whether we put computers as an expense the first year or put them in as assets. And if you're buying just a laptop or two, I just put them in as expense. Now, if you've got a manufacturer and you need all this type of equipment, that would go into the assets. Okay. So you'll come up with other things that'll go there. Sometimes I even tell people to put a contingency budget in there just for rainy days or just a build up for safety, like if a machinery breaks down, you've got a little built-in nest egg there. That's the way we can allow for it here. In all reality, you would probably pull some money out and put it in an interest-bearing account so that you can actually earn something on it. This other expenses, don't put anything in there. There's nothing I've seen that's appropriate there that wouldn't go on the top part. Okay. The balance sheet. Can you see that? Probably looks better online. I'll get it open online. In fact, I can't even read this balance sheet enough to talk about it. Whichever methods it tells you here on the left that are preferred, that's what you'll click on. It looks like the first one is method one. In the second session under assumptions about inventory, it can be method one or two, but I recommend that you use method two in that particular instance, and I'll tell you why. And then in assumptions for accounting, you use method one. Why it's using method one on receivables and payables is because you are a young business. They are not going to give you what we consider really short loans on product. You're going to have to pay up front, okay? And you aren't in the business of loaning money, so you're not going to give people terms unless it's really part of the industry standard. You're going to have a lot of cash to be able to do that up front. So for the most part, you can't afford to loan money and you're too new, people aren't going to give you terms to buy product. So we just say, we're not doing that. The middle one is about inventory. There's two ways that you can account for inventory. You can account for percentage of your sales or percentage of your inventory. There's a problem with that though. Say you have, okay, I'm going to use the example of a restaurant, even though I'm not letting you do any restaurants. inventory not only would be food, but inventory is also my forks, my plates, and my knives, and my cups, and my glasses, and my tablecloths, and all those things. But those things, I don't sell every time I use them, right? Or get rid of and buy new ones. So we have to do the inventory. That's the second one. It's inventory by change. And so you will put how much inventory you need. And at peak or low seasons, you will only put the change in the inventory. So the inventory will maintain the same because you're going to keep buying it. And, you know, people buy it, you sell it, you're going to keep doing that. But it's going to maintain a level of inventory that's consistent for your business. Now, at Christmas, maybe your inventory needs to go up if it's a product that's popular at Christmas. Maybe there's a time of the year you're selling umbrellas in the summer, it needs to go down because it's not raining. So you can do a change in the inventory, but the overall inventory will stay the same. Okay? And that's something else you'll need to learn in your industry analysis. You need to learn the seasonality. Okay, what's happening? What are the high and the peaks? So that you're not stuck with a bunch of inventory. Whatever you do, you don't want to not have the inventory because you can't sell it. Now, I know a lot of you are going to open businesses in smaller places, and they'll say, okay, order it for me. But I tell you, I grew up in big cities, Dallas and Houston and Austin, and if somebody didn't have something, you didn't say, please order it for me. And guess what we did? Yeah, we drove down the street to the next place. And now with the internet, oh, you don't have it? We don't like to wait. I was in line at McDonald's getting a drink driving back from, I was in New Orleans for the holidays, so I was driving back to Houston, and I was standing in line to where they sell all their drinks for a dollar now. And the guy went ballistic in front of me because the lady said the french fries are going to be another 60 seconds. And I thought, wow, we really want things quick. And so that's the way people buy things. If you don't have it, they'll go somewhere else. Okay? So we're really on instant gratification type of mode. Okay, the rest of this on the bottom, where it is, if you can't really tell, but that first column on the bottom is shaded. However, you will put zeros all the way down. Because that's for bringing over numbers from a pre-existing business and you aren't. Okay? So you just put zeros all the way down. So all you need to do on this one is select the methods and put zeros on that. And up at the top, it has some depreciations of different items. If you have items other than what is there, there's some depreciation that I, okay, when we get further down, I put a depreciation section in of what normal depreciation is for land. Some of them are already written in here for big pieces of equipment. You may have some things that are different. You may have to look in the industry to see how they are depreciated, but you want to put those things in. And so there's some here, if you need to change the names of them and change the depreciation or change the names of them to be more specific, then you can do that. But for the most part, the depreciation that's in there is fine. And then that depreciation will automatically take into account those items. If you name them the same here as on your balance sheet, then it's automatically going to put them into your depreciation on your income statement. Okay? The next one is your cash flow. You know, they say cash is king, right? You can see a lot of times businesses are very, very successful, but they're cash poor and they go under. You can't operate without cash. Now, there's this nice little chart here. And the reason it's there is because there's never a time your cash can be negative. If you figure that out, I'd like to know what bank you use, because my bank doesn't say, oh, Donna, you're $300 negative this month. Take care of that next month when you get change. Okay? There's never a time you can run a negative checking account balance, right? Well, you can. It costs you a lot of money, and it's not a good thing to do. Okay? So cash flow per month can never be negative. But your profits can, right? On the income statement, you're going to probably, it's not unusual for the first year for you to run a negative profit the whole first year. Now, if it continues to be negative or get deeper and deeper negative, you might want to say something's going on here and this isn't a business to go into. Having said that, though, I do not want you to think that whether your business shows a profit or a success is an A or an F. Okay? I am looking at this that you've covered all bases. If we knew every business plan was going to be an A business plan and be successful, there'd be no reason to write it. So sometimes writing a business plan for an idea you have, to pencil it out, you may say, no way. Or you make some drastic decisions. I'm going to have to rent a cheaper location. I can't buy it right now. I'm going to have to rent. I may need to go to a bigger city so I have a larger target market. Those are the types of decisions you're going to have to make. And I've had students before dead set on putting something in a particular location, and we find out there is just not enough of a target market to sustain that business. So they move it. Okay? So you need to be looking at those things. But even if you've done everything possible, and it loses money, and I say to you during your presentation, is this a business you're going to pursue? What should your answer be? No. Yeah. But it has no effect on your grade. It might have an effect on your grade if I said, and we knew long ago, that you were too narrow in your market, in the wrong location, selling your product too high, or product was priced too low, and the expense for it was too high, something, or and you didn't correct it. That could have an impact. Okay. The break-even analysis, I'm not concerned that you do it. If you want to do it, make sure you can understand it and do it. But that is not one. Did I miss the balance sheet? We did the balance sheet. Yeah. Okay. So that's kind of an overview of what you need to do. And what I also tell students, you're going to have that outline for your paper. You're going to have your financial sheet. If you have those two documents open all the time, the minute you write something in your paper, think about, is money associated with this? If it is, go ahead and stick in your financials. Doing the financials at the end is not a smart idea. What happens is you forget something, and I don't. Because when I go through and grade your paper, I circle all the things that better appear in the financials. Okay? So if you do it as you go and you put them in there, they may need to be altered later. But if you're putting things in there as you go, like all of a sudden you said you're going to sponsor a little league and you're going to buy them t-shirts. And I'm saying, what'd you buy them for? It's not showing up anywhere here. Okay? And where would that go? No, it's not. Probably advertising, right? So you're going to have a slide that says advertising. It's going to have this huge amount, but there's going to be an assumption sheet. So advertising, I want to know, $50 were for shirts, $300 were for an ad in the newspaper, $600 was for to have my webpage developed. It's going to be broken down. So even though you're going to lump things like advertising, utilities, those need to be broken down to what those utilities are. Because it could be internet connections, it could be water, it could be trash, it could be all types of different things. So you'll break those down. But for purposes of the spreadsheet itself, you can categorize them. Right? So those aren't so big and scary, are they? How many people are still scared about the financials? What did I say was scary?
I'm thinking about, like, for example, the balance sheet. I learned it in a different way.
Okay, but you'll be okay because this does a lot of the work. But guys, I'm not leaving you on your own. That's not the last time we're going to talk about it. We're probably going to talk about it every day. We're going to have a session where we go into a lab and I walk around and help you with them. So please don't put it aside, this big scary thing. I'm going to work with you on it all along the way. Okay? And really, it's as simple as I really said. For some reason, we all get scared about it. It really is that simple. Okay? Now, when you start doing some complex things and your seasonality changes, you just need to make sure it's reflected. And I'm going to tell you how, and we're going to talk about this very extensively, probably Wednesday, how you determine your sales or how you forecast what your sales are going to be. And that's the number that's going to appear right in there. That's the main number of that. You got to start with your sales first and then go out from there, because you don't know where you are. You may put your sales in and nothing works out. So, okay, I was too conservative there. I got to either expand my area How many of you have used the, we call it Ezri, BAO, all the different GIS type of stuff? Okay, there's also some information on here where you can go, and Connie will also talk about it a little bit. What this is a software system that we use here in the School of Business. It's widely known. There's a class that we teach just on this, BA 450 GIS. How many of you have taken that? That's where you know it from. You know, use these students to help you. It's a really cool program. And you can do things like, don't use you. Is that what you, yeah. If you want to say, I'm going to be located here, and I want to know in a 10-mile radius how many dogs are in that 10-mile radius if I'm doing something that relates to pets, it'll come back and tell you. I mean, I kid around, it'll tell you how many treats they get each day, too. It's not quite that, but it will do areas. It will also, I mean, it does very extensive data research. That needs to be included in your target market area. It probably needs to be included in your industry analysis as well. Now, when you go on to do it, you need to make sure you follow the directions extensively. Because when you open it up, if you see dollar signs going down of all the reports, how much they're going to cost, and some of them are like $500, $600, you're going to know you're in the wrong spot. You did not go through the back door of the School of Business or the university. Those should all be zero. So that's your clue that you did not log on correctly. If you're saying every report says $500, no. If you're having to spend any money on this program to get any reports, you did not go in the right way. Do not spend any money. Okay? Connie can help you with that. I can help you with that. Students here can help you with it. You guys are better at it than me.
Easy way is just go to the library page.
And Connie's got it directly there. Mm-hmm. I think that's what she gave me here. And this is Connie's website here. Connie's website, for those of you online, at the bottom has two videos, which will be equivalent to what she's going to teach the online, I mean the face-to-face students, Monday in class, so you'll review those. What else am I going to give you? Okay, let me talk about these sheets I gave you on writing. So on the writing section, I've got three different handouts there that I gave you. One of them is the quotations handout here. Quotations should be used very sparingly. But pretty much say you're not going to use them. Unless you're quoting Kennedy, a part of Kennedy's speech, you do not need to be using quotations. You need to be paraphrasing. I gave you a sheet on paraphrasing. It showed ones that, you know, look like plagiarized. This one's borderline. This one's paraphrased. Okay? You need to be paraphrasing the information. Okay? You cannot copy information directly, not even any four words together, and call it your own work. And you must do in-text citations, and you must have a reference list at the end. Speaking of that, the difference between a bibliography and a reference list are what? You guys know? Tina, you should know. We talked about this in 428. You remember? No?
Yes. Isn't the reference one the stuff that you might have looked at but you didn't actually cite?
The other way around.
Oh, the other way.
Yes. Works cited and reference list are the same. You only put the things that you're citing in the paper. A bibliography may be things that you looked at that had an influence on what you wrote, but you didn't directly cite them. We're going to use interchangeably a reference list and works cited are the same. Okay? So make sure that you're using APA form. There's an APA builder that is built into a lot of the Word programs now, but there's also some on the website that Connie will also go over with you. But quotations, I have literally had someone with a 10-page paper put a quote at the top and a quote at the bottom and call it good and say, I cited it, I'm clear. That is plagiarism still, okay? So getting little quotes that have to be very significant. It's not someone said that the data for this in year 2010, that the market increased 10%. That's not something you need to quote just because you don't feel like changing the words around, making it your own. The other sheet I gave you, which I don't have a copy of in front of me, was a writing handbook, how to avoid plagiarism. That's also something I highly recommend. And like I said, the paraphrasing one gives you examples of here's how it was written, now here's how it looks paraphrased. Okay? Yes. Put your hand up. Oh, okay. Any questions on those? Okay. I have this page here called Things to Avoid, and the reason I didn't hand it out to you, because I bet you guys will give me more things to add to it as we go along. But things to avoid. Maybe you'll save my green pens. Do not start a sentence with a number. And what I mean is the number written out that way. You can spell it out. Now, who wants to write out 1972? You don't want to start a sentence with that. So what are you going to do? Oh, let's just add the word in front of it, okay? So sometimes you might want to change it so it doesn't start with a number. If it has to start with a number, you need to spell the number out. Be sure to format appendices correctly. And appendices, we'll talk more about those, but the first time appendix is talked about in the paper, it becomes A. I've had people say, well, I put them in alphabetical order in the back, and then I just did them. And so the first appendix is a reference appendix D. Okay? You don't do that. They're the order in which they come in. And we'll talk more on how to reference those in the table of contents and stuff when we get there. Reference graphs in a write-up. Not only do you add a graph in there, I've had papers where I'm reading a paragraph and plump, there's a graph, a paper, plump, and there's no reference in the writing to say, as you can see in the graph below, it seems to be an increase over the last 10 years or a decline. Make some kind of reference and also name it. Okay? You're going to put graph 1.1 colon and what it is. And it's probably going to have a source over to the right. Source, colon, and where it came from as well. And we'll talk more about that too. Give a title below the graphs and tables. I just said that. Do not use contractions. Oh my gosh, I'll go nuts. Okay? Do not use contractions. Don't use contractions. Right? Contractions to me are a very informal type of writing. I'm going to give you an example, and it really proved it more to why I came back and bolded and underlined this. I was on a search committee, and I was reading cover letters for a vice president position. And one letter was just written beautifully. Wow, God, I got to make sure I don't just look at this because it's written so well. I got to make sure the content's there, too. I opened up the next one, and every sentence had a contraction in it. I couldn't even hardly read it. This was for a VP position. Okay? So in casual talking and casual writing, and you may find other professors aren't so strict on that, but Tina knows I'm very strict on contractions. Don't do them. Do not do them. Okay? Do not use words, and I will add more to this list. You cannot say, I'm going to sell about 20. No, you are the person selling it. You're going to sell 21 or 22 is what you're going to forecast. You cannot say the industry is, the industry's growing. Growing at what? Okay? Or this has already been done. Already? It's previously been done or currently being done or something. Try to get rid of some much. There's many. How many customers do you have? I had a lot of customers. Okay? No, how many do you have? So I'm just trying to get you to be specific in this. Pretty satisfied, maybe, approximately. You might do approximately in your industry analysis if that's what they gave you. But when it comes time for your numbers, you cannot say approximate. You are the owner of those numbers, and it shouldn't be approximate. You should know how it is. So you can't say, approximately get 10 customers a day. No, how many are you going to forecast that you're going to get? So there's lots of words, and I'm sure I'll add more. Oh, love's not on there. Add love to it. Okay, we're gonna put love in there. And very is my other pet peeve. Okay, don't use very. So make sure before you turn in your first paper, you do this. Okay, be sure and number pages correctly. Type out numbers less than 10. Now there is a little bit of a rule to that, but for the most part, any number under 10 you type out. Okay, the others you can write. Periods go after the citation. So after the in-text citation, you put the parentheses, the period goes after. And that's a common mistake. I don't know where people pick that up, that they put the period and then the reference. But the reference is part of that sentence, so put the period after the parentheses. Yes?
I actually, just as a reminder, had to go and look up the proper way to do in-text citations, and that's how they give you the example.
Okay. With a period that put in front of it? Mm-hmm. No, that's exactly wrong. Okay. I'll guarantee you.
Oh, I'll be good.
Guarantee. I just came back from New Orleans. I hope I don't say anything else like that. All right. Periods at the end of the sentence go within the quotation marks if you're using quotations. And some people think the period goes after. Even if it's just a part of the sentence that's quoted. And I was actually learned in taught in high school that in if there was quotations just part of the sentence, then it went outside. But if it was the whole, no, it went one way or the other. Anyway, it always goes on the outside. Internet is always capitalized. Okay. Do not write in first person, such as we and I. I don't want any of that type of stuff. It's the management team, the owner. The business is not a pronoun. It's an it. So if you're referring to the business, it's an it, unless you're referring to the management team, people-wise. But the business is an entity, and it's referred to as it. It's and it's, well, you right away know I'm not going to allow it in. It's is a contraction, that's it is. The possession of it's, it is it's without an apostrophe, which is different than everything else, right? Because if I said that's Donna's book, the apostrophe S would go for my possession, but that's opposite when it's it's. So this is the possession of it's. This means it is, and you can't use contractions. Then and then, make sure you understand the difference on those two. This refers to time. This is usually referring to a measurement. This is greater than this. Do not use word. Oh, really? Did it turn off up there?
Yeah.
Good lighting.
Would you mind? Can you reach it okay?
Probably not hot.
The temp light's not on. Just unless the bulb went out, the lamp light's not on.
Oh. Okay, well, I'll add more to that list and we'll pick up from there. But there were a couple. Did anybody see what the last one was?
Not use the word kid for
yes.
Children.
I get a lot of students that do daycares and type things. Don't refer to them as kids, they're children. So I think we did get through the whole list. So, how do you feel so far?
Better.
A little bit better.
Better?
Better to get the frightened version notes from the 4th to the 5th edition because on page 390, whatever, I don't see an outline.
It's on 373.
373, yeah.
Anybody else need a conversion sheet?
Yeah,
that
might be.
Maybe not nobody needs it.
We have
am I using the 4th and that's the 5th?
Yeah.
Okay, then you all need it. You know, I have to tell you a funny story about how I got that book. I'm a lover of a bargain. Sometimes I buy it just because it's a bargain and I don't even need it. So I love going to garage sales. I'm a garage sale junkie.
Oh, wow.
And I went to this garage sale, and all of a sudden I heard these three guys go, oh, crap, that's Dr. Lane. Get out of here. I was like, oh, it's coming to a garage sale. And they were rummaging around like crazy. They had put all their business books in the garage sale, and they didn't want me to see it. And I finally made them tell me what they were talking about. So I bought all their books. And that's the one I have with his writing. And so it's always funny to me to see what he thought was important or what he should do. Sometimes I think he was doing something other than listening. But, so that's why I'll get the other edition so you don't flip him back and forth. But yes, he was worried that I think he was selling for a quarter too. And I probably bargained him down to a nickel. A couple more sheets I want to hand out, and these will also be online. By the time you students that are online view the video. This is just another assistance to kind of help you understand the layout of the financials. and what's really happening and how all the financial sheets talk to each other. Just leave them at whatever end when you get there. I'm going to give you another one. The first page of it is some of the things we just talked about in the financials, but the other pages aren't going to make sense to you yet. So make sure that you're bringing all these handouts to class each time as we reference them. I'm just trying to get them off my plate onto you instead. What I have here is called the elevator pitch, and it is a link on the website already on Moodle. It's kind of probably overkill to give you this handout. However, I want to really express the importance of what we call an elevator pitch. Anybody know what an elevator pitch is? Amber?
It's selling yourself or whatever it is you're trying to sell to someone in 30 seconds
using
the time that you're in an elevator with them.
Yeah, you would think, I don't know, did they stamp 30 seconds on it? I haven't heard that, but it's something very concise. And the reason I want you to understand that is because until you can, when someone says, what's your business plan on, until you can say it as an elevator pitch, you don't really know what your business plan is. Okay? Until you can say it that way, you don't understand your focus and your direction. So practice your elevator pitch. And where do you think is a great place to get some good reviews about elevator pitches?
In an elevator?
Not in our elevator here. God, it was the first time I was in it. It was kind of scary.
That was so scary.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
What? Where do you think? Any ideas?
Infomercials,
you're getting close. Shark Tank.
Oh, yes.
Is that not like the coolest show ever? Oh. It's on YouTube. You can go on the video, look at any of the episodes. But how those people come out, they're a group of people that have been in a product or have a service or some idea, and they've gone in front of a group of $1 billion investors, and they pitch their idea and they decide whether they're going to invest in it or not. But when they come out, that pitch they give is their elevator pitch. They've got to convince them very quickly and show them their product and what it can do and where they are in their process very quickly. And then they say yes or no, they're going to invest. They'll ask a couple questions. And questions are really neat too, because, well, you'll start sitting there and go, you big dummy, why did you say that? Now you're not going to get it. Or you'll see people walk away from $1 billion because they were too stubborn to do a change that one of the guys asked them to do. There was a guy one time who came on, and he had a winery, and he had developed a glass. Amber, you may know about this since you're in hospitality. He developed a glass, a wine glass, that was sealed so that you could just sell a glass of wine, but it didn't lose like a bottle that's corked. It kept, and he invented this. He was a chemist, and he also had a winery. But he only wanted to use that for his wine. And they kept saying, no. We need to patent this and sell it to all the wineries. And they were gonna give him billions of dollars, and he was gonna be a billionaire overnight. And he said, oh no, it's only for my wine. And he would not do it. They brought him on the show a second time, and he walked away from it a second time too. Okay. So sometimes, yeah, that's what you'd look on the show and say, or then you say, who is going to buy that? So they're really fun shows to watch. They're on Friday night. I know you have better things to do on Friday night. However, you can go on YouTube. You can find a whole series of them on YouTube. It's called Shark Tank.
It's on Hulu, too.
What's that?
It's on Hulu.
Hulu, it's on Hulu as well. I'm sure it's other places as well. But make sure that you watch some of those episodes. But the reason... you may or may not be in an elevator with a billionaire someday and want to pitch your idea. That's not really why I proposed that elevator pitch to you, but that's to help you really know what your business is. Okay? Because if you can't come out with an elevator pitch about your business, then you're still all over the board too. If you say, well, I'm kind of going to do this and I might do this and I'm thinking about this, oh, yeah, that sounds like good. I'll throw that into, and you're talking like investors go, you not know. But I mean, you come out with a very concise, we're going to do this, we're going to forecast this, we check the industry, and this market's growing by, you know, 200% a year, and blah, 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 and boom. This person's really done some research, looked it up. I think I want to invest in you. Did you guys see the scrubby? It's a little yellow scrub brush, and it's got a smiley face in it.
Oh, I have one of those.
I do too. Isn't it the greatest thing? Yeah. That was on Shark Tank.
The Scrub Daddy.
Scrub Daddy, that's what it is. And you can buy them at Bed Bath & Beyond. That guy's a millionaire now. But the smiley face was made so that you could pull a spoon through it and clean it, and the eyes were made to stick other things in. This thing will clean anything. The brush is, it's a sponge, it's really hard. The minute it gets wet, it gets soft. And you just rinse it out. I don't know, do they wear out?
We wore ours out.
Did you?
But it took a while.
It took a while. So everybody in our family got Scrub Daddies for Christmas. But they are, they're really cool. But things like that come out of Shark Tank, and they got up and presented stuff. So I highly recommend that you watch some of those and share them with us when you watch them, because you're all going to be looking at different series. It's been going on TV now probably 4 years. It's been on for a while. So as business students, you all should
be on season Shark Tank.
What's that?
They're on season 5.
You're on season 5, so does that mean 5 years or?
Okay. Ish.
Ish, yeah. Okay. All right. What else do you guys need from me?
Nothing yet.
Okay. Let me summarize. What'd you say?
A prayer.
A prayer? I'll pray for you. I got all the prayers in the world for you. You guys are going to be great. You cannot procrastinate in this class. You need to keep it going. I will give you more feedback than you've ever gotten in a class before. I'm not sure when I'm going to do that sleeping thing, but I will give you feedback so you're not at the end wondering what comes up. You're going to get feedback every single section. I'm going to print them all out, and I'm going to write all over them. My handwriting is atrocious. I used to get A. Remember when you had to... Why am I asking this group? When I was a child, we had penmanship classes.
I had penmanship classes.
You did?
Yeah.
Really? And I got an A in that. You won't believe that after you see my handwriting now.
I failed.
But I should fail now. So anyway, we'll do our best. I'll try because I'm in a hurry and I don't write very well anyway. So, but we'll make sure that you understand my notes. When I circle things means I didn't like it, or I put W next to it so the wording was too confusing, or, and I'll try to put notes to the side, and I'll say, how come, what makes you think this, where's your evidence, and things like that. So you'll have lots of feedback for all your papers. So what you need to start thinking about is who you're going to interview. You've got the interview assignment and where to post it and some questions you can review. That is due on the 26th of January. You'll just post it on Moodle. Then the group business plans, what I'm going to do is I will give those to you on Wednesday, the plan. I'm not really supposed to let you take them out, so if you don't bring the plan back, you're getting an F in the class. How's that for an incentive?
Okay.
So you hand me the plan back and you're relinquished. Well, you could still get an F. So I'm going to let you take those in your group, and you can read them, and you fill it out, you make the PowerPoint, and then when we come back to class a week from this Wednesday, you'll present them. Okay? And then at that point, we'll talk about financials a little more, because I'm hoping you'll have questions that have come up, you've had time to look at it. So open up the financial spreadsheet, save it today's day, put a few things in there if you know it already. Read through it, kind of understand how things are connected. Just get yourself familiar with it. It's the best I can ask of you right now. And then make your outline. Some of the things you may throw out, but it's a great place to have placeholders. So the interview is most crucial, doing your outline and getting familiar with financials. If you have not gotten a business plan idea approved yet, that is definitely your first task, and I will be on those today. I have meetings until 5, so it'll be this evening before I can go on and start reading more and improving. Seems like I have something else to tell you. You all know me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I know you. What's your name?
Christine?
I haven't had you in a class. No. Okay, I'm Donna. I don't think I've had you in a class.
We haven't had a class now.
I've seen you around. I think I've seen all of you, but only I've seen you a million times. There's only how many of you have had a class from me? BA-131?
Yeah. It was a freshman year.
Yeah, and then Tina just had one with me, and she's a glutton for punishment. You had a class with me?
131
years ago. Okay. All right. So I will work on getting to know new names and new faces, and we need to get those business plans going. So when we come into class Wednesday, we'll talk more extensively about the appendices and start talking about the chapters in the book that we need to do. I'm going to move those around a little bit because I moved the company description down to the bottom, but we'll get talking about those anyway. I'll probably have more handouts for you. You know what? Let me give you the rest of these handouts. And I'll have to take it. This was on the legal aspects of your business as far as you're going to be an LLC, sole proprietor, tells you the pros and cons of each. Okay, great. I'll pick them up. And then this one is one we're going to talk about when we get into competition. And I highly suggest you hang on to all of these. Like I said, bring them to class because we'll be calling for them. That way I don't have to hand out any more stuff.
Non-profits.
You mean that you haven't made the decision yet? Well, you need to make the decision sooner than later.
Well, I know that.
Yeah. But you can write in the idea you give me.
Yeah.
You can say you're still deciding on that.
Okay.
I just need to know the idea itself.
Okay. I posted my idea.
Okay, who was doing the IT repair? Found it, but I'll need to bring it back Wednesday. I'm really not going to let that go. That was already been indexed. All right. Now, a lot of BA 499 students go into Kathy's office, and all of the 499s are indexed in there, and you can look at them and do all this. I don't know if you really want to do that, guys. I mean, if there's some in there that you just want to look because it's an idea that's close to yours, there's no grades in there. So you're taking your chances going in there and getting them. Now, if you want to go in there and find some of the references or maybe kind of look and get some ideas that you think are good, but there's no way of knowing if you're copying or replicating something that was an F paper or an A paper. So I always caution students about going in there. You're welcome to go in there. Kathy will let you come in, you can sit at the table, even they can't leave.
Even if they didn't pass the class, their plan still gets indexed?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Or their BP evaluation assignment.
That's right. Okay, so you're welcome to do it. I don't encourage it very much, but students somehow feel better of seeing something. But you're going to have a chance to pick through a great deal of them. That whole box in the bottom is full on Wednesday to pick through one that may work. Well, for you understanding how they're laid out or how it shouldn't be laid out. Anything else for me? I feel like I'm forgetting. You have my cell number. You got my number when I'm in Mexico. Yes, my cell number. And if you send me a text, please identify yourself because I'm not going to know. I had students doing that all summer or last term. They'd send me a text. So what do you think about blah, blah, blah. Okay, who are you? What are we talking about? Because I don't have you all in my contact list. So please identify yourself. I have all your other information that I'll be carrying with me to Mexico so I can look up and know. But identify yourself. You won't be able to check my phone. I'm not going to have it turned on in Mexico. That's why I have that other number in Mexico. But email will be fine. I teach, listen to this deal I got. I fly out Wednesday night, all night long. Thursday, I just relax. And I relax Friday until about 5 o'clock. And then I teach from 6 to 9. And then I teach all day Saturday. And then I don't teach again until the next Friday. I teach half a couple hours, and then I teach Saturday, and then I come home.
What part of Mexico are you from?
Guanajuato. Are you familiar with that?
I've never been, but yes.
Yes. Dead center. It's a neat town. It's an old silver mine town. I love it.
So what dates are you going?
I have them on here as your independent research non-formal class dates.
Oh, okay.
So I'll only miss two class dates.
I see.
Yeah, nice. I leave on the red eye flight after, so I didn't miss your Wednesday class.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I think we're good. You guys have a lot of work. Do not procrastinate. Make sure you're staying ahead of the ball game here. All right, we're gonna do great things, guys.